Princeton University Press Audio presents Evil in Modern Thought, an Alternative History of Philosophy, by Susan Neiman, read by Susan Neiman. The great assumption that what has taken place in the world has also done so in conformity with reason, which is what first gives the history of philosophy its true interest, is nothing else than trust in providence, only in another form. Hegel, Introduction to the Lectures on the History of Philosophy. Introduction. Quote, "The aspects of things that are most important for us are hidden because of their simplicity and familiarity. One is unable to notice something because it is always before one's eyes. The real foundations of his inquiry do not strike a person at all. And this means we fail to be struck by what, once seen, is most striking and most powerful." End quote. Wittgenstein, Philosophical Investigations. The 18th century used the word Lisbon much as we use the word Auschwitz today. How much weight can a brute reference carry? It takes no more than the name of a place to mean the collapse of the most basic trust in the world, the grounds that make civilization possible. Learning this, modern readers may feel wistful. Lucky the age to which an earthquake can do so much damage. The 1755 earthquake that destroyed the city of Lisbon and several thousand of its inhabitants shook the Enlightenment all the way to East Prussia, where an unknown minor scholar named Immanuel Kant wrote three essays on the nature of earthquakes for the Königsberg newspaper. He was not alone. The reaction to the earthquake was as broad as it was swift. Voltaire and Rousseau found another occasion to quarrel over it. Academies across Europe devoted prize essay contests to it. And the six-year-old Goethe, according to several sources, was brought to doubt and consciousness for the first time. The earthquake affected the best minds in Europe, but it wasn't confined to them. Popular reactions ranged from sermons to eyewitness sketches to very bad poetry. Their number was so great as to cause sighs in the contemporary press and sardonic remarks from Frederick the Great, who thought the cancellation of carnival preparations months after the disaster to be overdone. Auschwitz, by contrast, evoked relative reticence. Philosophers were stunned, and on the view most famously formulated by Adorno, silence is the only civilized response. In 1945, Arendt wrote that the problem of evil would be the fundamental problem of post-war intellectual life in Europe. But even there, her prediction was not quite right. No major philosophical work but Arendt's own appeared on the subject in English, and German and French texts were remarkably oblique. Historical reports and eyewitness testimony appeared in unprecedented volume, but conceptual reflection has been slow in coming. It cannot be the case that philosophers failed to notice an event of this magnitude. On the contrary, one reason given for the absence of philosophical reflection is the magnitude of the task. What occurred in Nazi death camps was so absolutely evil that, like no other event in human history, it defies human capacities for understanding. But the question of the uniqueness and magnitude of Auschwitz is itself a philosophical one. Thinking about it could take us to Kant and Hegel, Dostoevsky and Job. One need not settle questions about the relationship of Auschwitz to other crimes and suffering to take it as paradigmatic of the sort of evil that contemporary philosophy rarely examines. The differences in intellectual responses to the earthquake at Lisbon and the mass murder at Auschwitz are differences not only in the nature of events, but also in our intellectual constellations. What counts as a philosophical problem and what counts as a philosophical reaction, what is urgent and what is academic, what is a matter of memory and what is a matter of meaning, all these are open to change. This book traces changes that have occurred in our understanding of the self and its place in the world from the early Enlightenment to the late 20th century. Taking intellectual reactions to Lisbon and Auschwitz as central poles of inquiry is a way of locating the beginning and the end of the modern. Focusing on points of doubt and crisis allows us to examine our guiding assumptions by examining what challenges them at points where they break down. What threatens our sense of the sense of the world? That focus also underlies one of this book's central claims. The problem of evil is the guiding force of modern thought. Most contemporary versions of the history of philosophy will view this claim to be less false than incomprehensible. For the problem of evil is thought to be a theological one. Classically, it's formulated as the question, how could a good God create a world full of innocent suffering? Such questions have been off limits to philosophy since Immanuel Kant argued that God, along with many other subjects of classical metaphysics, exceeded the limits of human knowledge. If one thing might seem to unite philosophers on both sides of the Atlantic, it's the conviction that Kant's work prescribes not just future philosophical references to God, but most other sorts of foundation as well. From this perspective, comparing Lisbon to Auschwitz is merely mistaken. The mistake seems to lie in accepting the 18th century's use of the word evil to refer to both acts of human cruelty and instances of human suffering. That mistake might come naturally to a group of theists who were willing to give God the responsibility for both, but it shouldn't confuse the rest of us. On this view, Lisbon and Auschwitz are two completely different kinds of events. Lisbon denotes the sort of thing insurance companies call natural disasters, to remove them from the sphere of human action. Thus, human beings are absolved of responsibility not only for causing or compensating them, but even for thinking about them, except in pragmatic and technological terms. Earthquakes and volcanoes, famines and floods, inhabit the borders of human meaning. We want to understand just so much about them as might help us gain control. Only traditional, that is, pre-modern theists, will seek in them significance. Auschwitz, by contrast, stands for all that is meant when we use the word evil today, absolute wrongdoing that leaves no room for account or expiation. Initially, then, no two events will strike us as more different. If there's a problem of evil engendered by Lisbon, it can occur only for the Orthodox. How can God allow a natural order that causes innocent suffering? The problem of evil posed by Auschwitz looks like another entirely. How can human beings behave in ways that so thoroughly violate both reasonable and rational norms? It is just this sense that the problems are utterly different which marks modern consciousness. The sharp distinction between natural and moral evil that now seems self-evident was born around the Lisbon earthquake and nourished by Rousseau. Tracing the history of that distinction and the ways in which the problems refuse to stay separate is one aim of this book. A central reason for locating the modern as beginning at Lisbon is precisely for its attempts to divide responsibility clearly. Close look at that attempt will reveal all its irony. Though the philosophes perpetually accused Rousseau of nostalgia, Voltaire's discussion of the earthquake left far more in God's hands than did Rousseau's. And when Rousseau invented the modern sciences of history and psychology to cope with questions the earthquake brought to the surface, it was in defense of God's order. Ironies notwithstanding, the consciousness that emerged after Lisbon was an attempt at maturity. If enlightenment is the courage to think for oneself, it's also the courage to assume responsibility for the world into which one is thrown. Radically separating what earlier ages called natural from moral evils was thus part of the meaning of modernity. If Auschwitz can be said to mark its ending, it is for the way it marks our terror. Modern conceptions of evil were developed in the attempt to stop blaming God for the state of the world and to take responsibility for it on our own. The more responsibility for evil was left to the human, the less worthy the species seemed to take it on. We are left without direction. Returning to intellectual tutelage isn't an option for many, but hopes for growing up now seem void. The history of philosophy, like that of nations or individuals, should teach us not to take for granted the intersection of assumptions where we find ourselves standing at particular moments in time. Learning this is a crucial part of the self-knowledge that was always philosophy's goal. But history of philosophy achieves such knowledge only when it is sufficiently historical. More often, the history of philosophy is approached as if our constellations and categories were self-evident. In broadest terms, we probably agree with Comte's view of intellectual history as progressing from theological to metaphysical to scientific ages. On such a view, thinkers whose world was shattered by the Lisbon earthquake would confirm all conviction in Enlightenment naivete. At best, their reaction seems quaint, a sign of intellectual immaturity befitting an era that found itself on the border between theology and metaphysics. If one believes the world is ruled by a good and powerful father figure, it's natural to expect his order to be comprehensively just. Jettison that belief, and whatever expectations remain are unresolved residues of childish fantasy. Thus, the intellectual shockwaves generated by Lisbon, when noticed at all, are seen as the birth pangs of a sadder but wiser era that has learned to live on its own. This view, I will argue, is itself a historical one, for nothing is easier than stating the problem of evil in non-theist terms. One can state it, for example, as an argument with Hegel. Not only is the real not identical with the rational, they aren't even related. To make this observation, you need no theory. Any observation of the world that continues for more than a couple of minutes should do. Every time we make the judgment, this ought not to have happened, we are stepping onto a path that leads straight to the problem of evil. Note that it is as little a moral problem, strictly speaking, as it is a theological one. One can call it the point at which ethics and metaphysics, epistemology and aesthetics, meet, collide, and throw up their hands. At issue are questions about what the structure of the world must be like to think and act within it. Those questions will quickly become historical. For what most demands explanation is not how moral judgments are justified, but why those that are so clearly justified were disregarded in the past. When one begins to seek explanation, one can end in anything from myth, like the fall, to metaphysics, like Hegel's phenomenology. What's important is that the place one begins is perfectly ordinary. I believe it is the place where philosophy begins and threatens to stop, for it involves questions more natural, urgent, and pervasive than the skeptical epistemological quandaries conventionally said to drive modern philosophy. It's possible to begin to worry about the difference between appearance and reality because you notice that a stick looks refracted in a pool of water, or because a dream is so vivid that you want to grasp one of its objects for a moment or two of sleepy half-consciousness. But you wake in your bed, slap your face if you have to, pull the stick out of the water if you're really in doubt. With a problem of evil that easy to dispel, the massive effort spent in hundreds of years of philosophy would be in need of explanation. The picture of modern philosophy is centered in epistemology, and driven by the desire to ground our representations, is so tenacious that some philosophers are prepared to bite the bullet and declare the effort simply wasted. Rorty, for example, found it easier to reject modern philosophy altogether than to reject the standard accounts of its history. His narrative was more polemical than most, but it's a polemical version of the story told in most philosophy departments in the second half of the 20th century. The story is one of tortuously decreasing interest. Philosophy, like some people, was prepared to accept boredom in exchange for certainty as it grew to middle age. What began as metaphysics, the description of basic structures of reality, ended as epistemology, the attempt to track, if not to ground, the foundations of our knowledge. On literary grounds alone, the narrative is flawed, for it lacks what is central to dramatic movement anywhere, a compelling motive. Except for the anachronistic desire to distinguish themselves from natural scientists, it's a narrative of philosophers who act without intention. The ground for earlier metaphysical inquiries is nearly as opaque as the motives for their successor. In both cases, great thinkers simply got stuck out of sheer curiosity investigating very general questions about the way things are. There's no good reason for the history of philosophy to have consisted in this story. As Descartes himself knew, none but madmen ever really think all our representations might be dreams. Throughout the Critique of Pure Reason, Kant wrote that something must account for the inexhaustible effort that philosophers devote to a subject that brings no results. He thought the labors could not be driven by pure speculation alone. They are too hard and too frustrating to be driven by purposes and problems that are not urgent. Kant's conclusion that speculative labors are moved by practical ends should not be read narrowly. For the last thing I wish to argue is that in addition to epistemology, the history of philosophy was also concerned with ethics. It was, of course, as contemporary work on the history of ethics has shown well. But the problem of evil shows the hopelessness of 20th century attempts to divide philosophy into areas that may or may not be connected. To see this, we needn't consider explicitly holist authors like Spinoza or Hegel. The most skeptical of empiricists himself should give pause. Which miracles did Hume want us to question? Which customs did he want us to keep? Was he more concerned with sympathy or with substance? Is Anna Karenina about love more than justice? 20th century philosophy is not unique in its ability to confuse puzzles with problems. Even Socrates did it sometimes. It's an ability that may be part of the impulse to question opinion with which philosophy began. Medieval philosophy revealed how questions not merely of life and death, but of eternal life and death, could turn into quandaries about substance. The dangers of sophistry and scholasticism are present in the possibility of philosophy itself. What is new is not these dangers, but a fragmentation of the subject that would have been foreign to philosophers from Plato to Nietzsche. This very fragmentation may prevent us from seeing the problem of evil for what it is. The fact that the world contains neither justice nor meaning threatens our ability both to act in the world and to understand it. The demand that the world be intelligible is a demand of practical and of theoretical reason, the ground of thought that philosophy is called to provide. The question of whether this is an ethical or metaphysical problem is as unimportant as it is undecidable, for in some moments it's hard to view it as a philosophical problem at all. Stated with the right degree of generality, it is but an unhappy description. This is our world. If that isn't even a question, no wonder philosophy has been unable to give it an answer. Yet for most of its history, philosophy has been moved to try, and its repeated attempts to formulate the problem of evil are as important as its attempts to respond to it. Let me summarize the claims for which I will argue. First, 18th and 19th century philosophy was guided by the problem of evil. Like most short statements, this one is too simple. Nevertheless, I intend to show that as an organizing principle for understanding the history of philosophy, the problem of evil is better than alternatives. It's more inclusive, comprehending a far greater number of texts, more faithful to their authors' stated intentions, and more interesting. Here, interest is not merely an aesthetic category, important as that is, but also an explanatory one, which answers Kant's question. What drives pure reason to efforts that seem to have neither end nor result? Second, the problem of evil can be expressed in theological or secular terms, but it is fundamentally a problem about the intelligibility of the world as a whole. Thus, it belongs neither to ethics nor to metaphysics, but forms a link between the two. Third, the distinction between natural and moral evils is itself a historical one that developed in the course of the debate. Fourth, two kinds of standpoint can be traced from the early Enlightenment to the present day, regardless of what sort of evil is in question, and each is guided more by ethical than by epistemological concerns. The one, from Rousseau to Arendt, insists that morality demands that we make evil intelligible. The other, from Voltaire to Jean Amary, insists that morality demands that we don't. My own sympathies tend toward the former line of views, while acknowledging the force of the latter. This allows me, I hope, to answer the objection that is most troubling. The problem of evil facing the 18th century was so different from our own that comparing them involves not just conceptual but moral confusion. Comparing Lisbon to Auschwitz can seem not mistaken but monstrous, for it risks either viewing the latter as one more or less natural disaster, thus excusing the architects, or comparing the creator to criminals of the worst sort. It is hard to say which is worse, contemplating the redemption of the commandant of Auschwitz or the violation of images of God even atheists want to retain. For this reason, apart from isolated remarks, the two events have been left to stand as symbols for the breakdown of the worldviews of their eras, and the question of how we got from one to the other has not been addressed. If some easiness about understanding seems right to preserve, I trust it will shape inquiry rather than preclude it. Among the many things this book will not offer is a definition of evil, or criteria for distinguishing evil actions from those that are simply very bad. This might be a task for a book of ethics, but the problem of evil concerns something else. To describe that problem, one might ask, what's the difference between calling one action evil and another a crime against humanity? They can often be interchanged. But a crime is something for which we have procedures, at least for punishing, if not for preventing. To say this is to say that a crime can be ordered, fit in some manner into the rest of our experience. To call an action evil is to suggest that it cannot, and that it thereby threatens the trust in the world that we need to orient ourselves within it. I will argue that evils cannot be compared, but they should be distinguished. What happened on September 11th was one kind of evil. What happened at Auschwitz was another. Getting clear about the difference will not put an end to evil, but it may help prevent our worst reactions to it. To lament the loss of absolute standards for judging right and wrong ought to be superfluous a century after Nietzsche, but someone seems to do it every day. Nearly everyone who ever taught a humanities course will have met students who discovered that words like good and evil are out of date, since used by different cultures in different ways. What may have gone unnoticed is that while few today will claim certainty about general ethical principles, most are quite certain about particular ethical paradigms. Loss of certainty about the general foundations of value has not affected certainty about particular instances of it, perhaps quite the contrary. 3 centuries ago, when foundations were said to be more solid, public torture to death was widely accepted. Today, it is pretty universally condemned, regardless of differences over principle. As Rwanda or Bosnia can show us, universal condemnation may be worth next to nothing. My point is about the relation not of theory to practice, but of general principle to particular paradigm. There may be no general principle that proves torture or genocide wrong, but this does not prevent us from taking them to be paradigmatic of evil. I therefore assume that we have such examples and that they change over time without any interest in giving justification or even criteria for them. Even if we lack general principles of the kind we imagine other ages to have cherished, this is enough for my purposes. Since I do not think an intrinsic property of evil can be defined, I am rather concerned with tracing what evil does to us. If designating something as evil is a way of marking the fact that it shatters our trust in the world, it's that effect, more than the cause, which I want to examine. It should follow that I have even less intention of solving the problem of evil than I do of defining evil itself. My interest is rather to explore what changes in our understanding of the problem of evil reveal about changes in our understanding of ourselves and of our place in the world. I proceed on the increasingly shared assumption that examining the history of philosophy can be a way of engaging in philosophy itself. Traditional intellectual history might proceed by chronicling successive thinkers' accounts of evil and tracing sources and patterns of influence. Traditional philosophical studies might evaluate the success of competing accounts and try to offer a better one. My goal is another entirely: to use different responses to the problem of evil as a means of understanding who we have become in the 3 centuries that separate us from the early Enlightenment. This book began as the study of an interesting topic, oddly ignored in the historiography of philosophy. It soon threatened to explode all confines. If I'm even close to correct, the problem of evil is so pervasive that an exhaustive and systematic treatment of it would require an exhaustive and systematic treatment of most of the history of philosophy. Merely listing the right names can seem hopeless. Instead of attempting such a project, I've made several choices that eschew it. First, I've limited my discussion to that period beginning with the Enlightenment and dated the Enlightenment as beginning in 1697 with the publication of Bayle's Dictionary. There are good reasons for dating it earlier. One would be to explore Gnostic imagery in the person credited with fathering modern philosophy, René Descartes. Descartes' evil demon is not a thought experiment, but a threat. Unlike its pale air, the brain in the vat, the devil was a real concern. What if the world were created by a being whose whole purpose was to cause us torment and illusion? God knows it sometimes looks that way. If the absence of Descartes may seem troubling, that of Spinoza may be worse. Both are clearly crucial for understanding later discussion of these problems, but then so is Plato. One could easily spend a lifetime studying the problem of evil and be no better for it. Instead, I've chosen to restrict discussion to its development from the beginning of the period in which we began to be most recognizably who we are. If history, as Bayle wrote, is the history of crimes and misfortunes, attempts to make sense of it are doomed not just to falsehood, but to ridicule. It's a choice, but not an arbitrary one, to view the Enlightenment as beginning under pressure to prove Bayle wrong. Even within those confines, this study cannot be exhaustive, and to mark this, I've chosen non-chronological form. Though my interest is in the development of ideas such as those that link Rousseau's second discourse to Arendt's Eichmann in Jerusalem, I've explored such development thematically. So I've grouped thinkers according to the views they held about the nature of appearances. Is there another, better, truer order than the one we experience? Or are the facts with which our senses confront us all there is? Is reality exhausted by what is, or does it leave room for all that could be? Dividing philosophers according to their stance on one large question is rough division and produces odd alliances. Among philosophers who insisted on finding order in addition to the miserable one presented by experience, I include Leibniz, Pope, Rousseau, Kant, Hegel, and Marx. Among those who denied the reality of anything beyond brute appearance, I discuss Bayle, Voltaire, Hume, De Sade, and Schopenhauer. Nietzsche and Freud cannot be fit into either division, however broadly construed, but raise sufficiently similar questions to deserve their own chapter. As I argue in the final chapter, the 20th century presents particular philosophical problems. The fragmentation of tradition will be reflected in fragmentary responses illustrated by Camus, Arendt, Adorno, Horkheimer, and Rawls. Grouping philosophers this way overlooks many crucial differences between them. But it's no cruder than the division of thinkers into rationalists and empiricists, a schema with which it is partly coextensive. The latter will seem more natural to those who believe that the guiding questions of modern philosophy are questions about theory of knowledge. If these are your main concern, you will group philosophers according to whether they believe the main source of knowledge to be reason or experience, and will view other differences between them as incidental. Yet this division was not obvious to Kant, who is credited with overcoming it, or to Hegel, the modern philosopher who devoted most thought to the history of philosophy itself. For the critique of pure reason, the first controversy in the history of philosophy concerns appearance and reality. Are ideas or experience the final court of appeal? This question takes us through the history of philosophy all the way back to Plato. The worry that fueled debates about the difference between appearance and reality was not the fear that the world might not turn out to be the way it seems to us, but rather the fear that it would. Many of the thinkers discussed in Chapter 1 would reject each other's company. But despite occasional elements of melancholy, all are united by some form of hope for a better order than the one we experience. Those in Chapter 2, by contrast, share a brilliant, cheerful bleakness that concluded with Schopenhauer's stupendous pessimism. Nietzsche and Freud maintain a sort of heroic scorn toward discussions of the subject that preceded their own, and any straws we might be tempted to clutch thereafter. The thinkers chosen to illustrate 20th century thought about evil display humility born of a sense of fragility and awe. Thinkers can be grouped in terms that belong to metaphysics, how do they view the reality of appearances, as well as terms that come from psychology, do they make room for a fundamentally hopeful stance toward the world? I will argue that the problem of evil requires thought about both. The way we organize philosophical discourse is not the most important thing challenged by the problem of evil, but it is surely the easiest to change. In general, I focus on major figures in the canon. This underlines the fact that the problems discussed are not peripheral to the tradition, but basic to the work of its most central thinkers. Were this an ordinary history of philosophy, it would be irresponsible to discuss the transition from Kant to Hegel without discussing Fichte and Schelling, or to move from Hegel to Marx without discussing Feuerbach. I have done both, and probably things that are worse. My interest is less in tracing causal connections between authors than in showing how certain general developments make sense. For this, it should be enough to choose samples of work that were particularly exciting and important in the hope that they will illuminate the rest. But hundreds of rich and influential texts will thereby be ignored, and choices could have been made differently. The only consolation for the resulting inadequacy is the way in which it confirms my initial claim. The history of philosophy is so steeped in the problem of evil that the question is not where to begin, but where to stop. An attempt to be complete would be doomed to failure from the start. Should this book open lines of inquiry rather than exhaust them, it will have achieved its goal. I've called this an alternative history of philosophy because its aims are as different as its style and methods. One aim, in the felicitous expression of an anonymous reader, is to reorient the discipline to the real roots of philosophical questioning. I'm grateful for the metaphor, which allows me to argue that, in some form or another, the problem of evil is the root from which modern philosophy springs. Once brought to life, philosophical discourse can grow on its own, and its branches may extend or tangle in all directions. Thus, entire schools of thought could develop that have little to do with the questions raised here. Kant and Hume and Hegel all raised questions that would lead philosophers reading them centuries later to think about relationships between language and world or the foundations of knowledge. But if, as I argue, those questions are less central to the heart of their thought than was previously assumed, we must come to view our own philosophical landscape differently. This book is not merely intended to be of interest both to those who are professional philosophers and those who are not, but to show that throughout most of its history, philosophy itself was of interest both to those who were professional philosophers and those who were not. Like many others, I came to philosophy to study matters of life and death and was taught the professionalization required for getting them. The more I learned, the more I grew convinced of the opposite. The history of philosophy was indeed animated by the questions that drew us there. Thus, I have written in a manner that should be open to those without formal philosophical training, keeping notes and other scholarly apparatus to a minimum. In the spirit of that Enlightenment, then, in which Lessing and Mendelssohn co-authored essays for international prize contests on the relations between poetry and metaphysics, Kant wrote for the 18th century version of the New York Review, and de Sade begged to have volumes of Rousseau sent to him in the Bastille, this book is written in tentative hope. Chapter 1, Fire from Heaven. Quote, philosophy makes no secret of it. The confession of Prometheus, in one word, I hate all the gods, is its very own confession, its own sentence against all heavenly and earthly gods who refuse to recognize human self-consciousness as the supreme divinity, by the side of which none other shall be held. End quote. Marx's dissertation. He may be the first Enlightenment hero. Alfonso X became king of Castile in 1252, and his reign was full of trouble from the start. He repudiated his wife on the ground that she was barren, then sent to Denmark for another. By the time the princess of Denmark arrived in Spain, the queen was pregnant with the first of 9 children she would bring into the world. Neither woman ever forgave Alfonso, though his brother, Archbishop of Seville, gave up his seat to marry the Danish princess. The learning and eloquence that gave Alfonso a splendid reputation in other countries did not impress his Castilian contemporaries, who seemed to resent him. Though he was the first king of Castile, who caused public acts to be written in the Spanish tongue and commissioned a Spanish translation of the Bible, it didn't lead to the flowering of local culture that translations into the vernacular produced in neighboring France. Rather, many later historians held the works he sponsored to be responsible for the ignorance and barbarity they claimed spread over Spain. The children he had longed for turned out to be ingrates. One of them, Sancho, tired of waiting to inherit the throne, and conspired with the king of Granada to overthrow his father. Alfonso's death in 1284 put an end to the ensuing civil war, but not to his misfortune, for his will was entirely ignored. The rebel Sancho remained on the throne, and his own heart, which he had ordered buried on Mount Calvary, was left to molder with his other remains in Seville. Medieval and early modern thinkers viewed this saga as a confirmation of providence. All Alfonso's troubles were punishment for one nearly unspeakable sin, and hence were confirmation of God's presence, justice, and even capacity for irony. For Sancho's rebellion, in particular, was a fitting response to the rebellion his own father instigated against the Heavenly Father himself. Alfonso's revolt began as an act of scholarship. He sent to Toledo for learned Jews to instruct him in astronomy and commissioned one Rabbi Isaac Hazan to draw up astronomical tables, known thereafter as the Tablas Alfonsinas, at considerable expense. After several years of intensive study, Alfonso remarked, "If I had been of God's counsel at creation, many things would have been ordered better." This little sentence, or some variation of it, expressed the essence of blasphemy for close to half a millennium. Bale said no one was ignorant of Alfonso's astronomical studies and their consequences, and was scrupulous in footnoting numerous variants of the story. In several of them, even the rebellion of his son wasn't considered sufficient punishment. One who presumed to judge the heavens should be answered more directly, so a number of commentators had Alfonso or his family hit by lightning. A certain Rodrigo Sanctius wrote that an angel appeared in a dream to convey a message from the celestial council warning Alfonso to repent. Quote, "But Alfonso laughed and repeated his blasphemy. The night following, there were such horrible storms, accompanied with thunder and lightning, as if heaven was falling. The fire from heaven burned in Alfonso's chamber, the king and queen's clothes. Then the prince in distress sent for the hermit, confessed his sins to him, cried, humbled himself, and retracted his blasphemy. The more he wept, the more the storm diminished, and at last quite ceased." End quote. Bale contested this account and other versions involving lightning. Such a wonderful accident, he argued, would be confirmed by more sources, particularly if it took place in Spain, whose inhabitants were always delighted to find evidence of miracles. Bale wished to naturalize the story and may thereby be Alfonso's first defender. The king, in Bale's account, committed prosaic sins. He neglected domestic political interests in favor of astronomical learning, preferring to make a noise in foreign countries by cultivating his knowledge rather than attending to relations with his family and other subjects. Here we see ordinary, not criminal, narcissism. Though the former might render his subsequent downfall more comprehensible, Bale still did not think he deserved it. On the contrary, Bale devoted several footnotes to the infamous sentence and gave it a modern and more charitable reading. Alfonso's belief that the heavens looked remarkably disordered may be a comment not on God's workmanship, but on the defects of Ptolemaic astronomy, which were all too apparent by 1697. It all depends where the emphasis falls. Had Alfonso asserted, "If I had been of God's counsel at creation," it would indeed sound like scandalous conceit. But, Bale proposes, the claim could be read as follows: "If I had been of God's counsel at creation." In that case, the object of derision is not the creator, but the sorry medieval astronomers whose ridiculous system did no honor to him. Whether or not we sympathize with such nascent deconstruction, we're likely to support Bale and to go several steps further. Alfonso's remark will strike modern readers as so harmless that the wrath it provoked for centuries, much less the possible judgment of heaven, will be hard to understand. Even those who take patience and humility to be primary virtues can view Alfonso as manifesting them. He might, after all, have left the cosmic order to divine jurisdiction and devoted his attention to the business of earthly kings, like falconry and wenching. It would have been simpler and brought simpler rewards. All Alfonso got for the years spent learning to calculate epicycles was the dubious blessing of posthumous notoriety. Since it wasn't even good science, Not even a glimpse of the truth crowned his efforts. His life, by all accounts, looks a model of failure. Yet apart from the vanity that might afflict anyone, his motives were perfectly good ones. Alfonso sought to learn the secrets of the science that was viewed as the very highest, so as better to understand and revere the creation. And in uttering the remark that made him famous, there was no wish to blaspheme, just to point out the truth. An ordinary, hardworking Spanish king could design a better world than the one received wisdom ascribed to an omnipotent creator. His fate, therefore, will seem hardly more just than Job's, whose story of endless suffering was also paradigmatic for writers concerned with the problem of evil. It's important to note that, like Alfonso's misfortunes, Job's were not viewed as unfair until a very late date. Sometime during the Enlightenment, commentators stopped looking for ways in which Job's torments could be justified. According to Kant, who wrote a wonderful essay on the subject, they had previously done so in the hope that God would be eavesdropping. Having lost that hope, they had less motivation to try out variations on possible theodicies, which showed either that Job was secretly guilty of something after all, so that loss of all he had was justified punishment, or that he was being tried today to be rewarded the more surely tomorrow. Earlier writers identified with Job's friends, the theodicy makers, who found justification. Later ones identified with Job, who found none. Tracing this development might be an interesting way of spending a lifetime, which wouldn't be long enough to examine the vast literature the Book of Job inspired. But let us return to Alfonso, whose remark hardly reached the presumption of his biblical predecessor. Job did not go so far as to follow his wife's suggestion that he curse God and die. But he did curse the day he was born, close enough to cursing creation itself. Alfonso only suggested that it could be improved. I will argue that Alfonso is less harmless than we think. Medieval observers were not entirely mistaken in reading his wish to advise God as the first step in a process that led to something they could not have imagined. Not only the 19th century's wish to displace God, but Nietzsche's announcement that the deed had been done and was no longer even shocking. Let's begin by considering the functions Alfonso performed in the Enlightenment. God's advocates, Leibniz and Pope. Leibniz wrote that everyone condemns Alfonso's opinion that the world could be better. He joined in the general condemnation and wondered why, despite it, the world of philosophers and theologians contained so many latter-day Alfonsos. For anyone who thinks God could have made the world better and chose not to do so, thinks that God is not as good as he could be. Leibniz put the point gently. His theodicy is one long response to the work of Bale, who minced fewer words. History, said Bale, is the history of the crimes and misfortunes of the human race. A God who could have created a world that contained fewer crimes and misfortunes and chose not to do so seems nothing but a giant criminal himself. Leibniz invented the word theodicy to describe the defense of God in categories taken from legal discourse. Before we examine his defense, let us look at the attack that provoked it. Bale's work will be examined on its own terms in Chapter 2. Here I wish simply to mark what was exceptional in the charges he laid at God's door. God had been on trial since the book of Job, at the latest, and if the framers of that text pressed any point with clarity, it's that he had it coming. For we, the readers, can see that things are worse than even Job suspects. He begs for understanding. Suppose he had known that the death of his 10 children was the result of a bet God made with Satan, like two thuggish schoolboys contesting for power. One who undertakes to try the righteous in such ways will be called to account sooner or later himself. Job, who cannot read the prologue to his story, might be satisfied by God's mere appearance as a witness, but later ages would demand more in the way of defense. As the crimes he was charged with looked graver and graver, and he seemed unwilling even to appear to address the accusations, modern writers felt bound to condemn him, in absentia, to something like death. Bale argued that Christianity made the problem worse. Before Bale, it was easier to view Christianity as a sensible solution to the problem of evil. As one believer put it, Job is the question and Jesus is the answer. The details of the solution are as various as the differences in Christian doctrine, but the statement marks the belief in messianic redemption and the hope for eternal life at the core of any Christian view. God himself, in those views, took on as cruel a set of punishments as any human ever suffered. Indeed, they were made all the crueler by the fact of his utter innocence. His miraculous resurrection, which would make the agony on the cross seem a fleeting nightmare, is a prototype of that open to anyone who chooses to believe in the miracle. Belief in miracles for Bayle was not a problem. He regarded the world as generally mysterious. One more break in a rather incomprehensible natural order would pose no great difficulty. The problem lies rather in the internal structure of the Christian solution itself. The torments of the damned, even without the doctrine of predestination, are the block on which reason stumbles. For however bad a sin may be, it has to be finite. An infinite amount of hellfire is therefore simply unjust. To imagine a God who judges many of the forms of life he created to be sinful, then tortures us eternally for our brief participation in them, is hardly to imagine a solution to the problem of evil. Positing a God who may permit infinite and eternal suffering is of little help instilling doubt about a God who clearly permits finite and temporal suffering. Matters were far worse for those who accept the doctrine of predestination. Though neither Bayle nor Leibniz did so, both took it very seriously. Manichaean heresies viewed the world as ruled by good and evil principles forever engaged in conflict. Bayle thought Manichaeism would be far more prevalent had it developed in an age that took predestination as seriously as did his own. Anyone who believes that our worldviews have become less heartening over time should recall the basic elements of that doctrine. According to Calvinism, the number of those who will be eternally damned is much larger than the number of those who will be eventually saved. Who shall be redeemed is decided by God at or before the moment of birth. Any action you perform may reflect your prospects of burning forever, but nothing you can do will affect them. Sod himself made an effort, but was unable to invent something worse, and no modern tyrant even tried. Death is a mercy here entirely lacking. Torture without limit falls on unbaptized babies, noble princes, and brutal gangsters alike, and its author is the creator we are bound to revere. The doctrine is the logic of omnipotence gone mad. Is the creator all-powerful? But of course. Then he can do what he wants? Just the meaning of power. Can he break all the laws? Well, he made them. Laws of reason? We should judge him. Laws of justice? Ditto, likewise. Any justice? If he chooses. Every step is unexceptionable till we are led to a system choked with evil so inscrutable that we turn to modern worldviews for relief. Sheer randomness will be a respite. It is just the randomness of guilt and punishment, along with the presence of good as well as evil, that creates philosophical problems. For even Bayle knew that life contains something besides vice and pain. The fact that we sometimes meet up with virtue and happiness is just what's confusing. If all of humankind were wicked and miserable, we could conclude it to be the creation of a wicked and miserable deity who created in his own image and for his own perverse pleasure. If the justice of such a world weren't obviously apparent, it would be hard to find anyone who might care. But this is not the world we live in. Bayle says it's the mixture of happiness and suffering, wickedness and virtue, that leads us to reflection and makes Manichaeism seem the most reasonable of views. The picture of a world ruled by good and evil principles locked in perpetual struggle preserves belief in God's benevolence. Far from being the author of sin and misery, God is always attempting to prevent it. He is simply hindered by the strength of his opponent. If this view makes God into a large and long-living parent, well-meaning but bounded, it does less violence to our intuitions than do other options. It may be hard to acknowledge God's limits, but it's less frightening than denying his goodwill. Manichaeism may not explain experience, but it certainly seems to reflect it by underlining the bewildering alternation between good and evil that structures human life. Alfonso would have been unlikely to mutter if the natural world presented nothing but flawed machinery. It is just the presence of some matchless order, along with the existence of other parts without rhyme and reason, that caused his complaint. Some experience of understanding creates expectations of more. To be sure, the belief in such order long preceded modern science. Kant thought it was manifest in the change of the seasons. The fact that delicate flowers are preserved through winter storms should suffice to convince any skeptic that the world was designed by an awesome creator. And if the coming of spring may seem more of a miracle in East Prussia than in the south of Spain, it's an event that can evoke wonder anywhere. Ordinary wonder at the world's bit of order makes ordinary experience fractured. Discontinuity between understanding and blind groping, decency and horror, frames the texture of our lives. Thus, Bale concludes, Manichaeism is the most reasonable response to experience. Let us take his conclusion at face value. Reason's response to experience is a demand for Manichaeism. Faith's response is affirmation of Christianity. In 1697, even the progressive Holland where Bale was writing, it is not hard to guess which of the two will be condemned. No wonder Bale was happy to take up Alfonso's defense, for the king's mild-mannered suggestion put a foot in the door. Alfonso stood for any claim that human reason contains in itself more sense and order than the world it faces. Bale's belief in the general incomprehensibility of all things used Alfonso as a champion. Leibniz had to rebut him in the effort to show the world to be in principle transparent. So he took up Alfonso 13 years later. Bale had argued that reason and all the evidence of experience leave God condemned. Any attempt to retain faith will not only lack rational foundation, it must positively defy it. The theodicy thus sets out to prove the conformity of faith with reason, though for later readers like Voltaire, it served to prove the absurdity of faith in reason. Leibniz undertook to defend a creator accused of unparalleled crime. His defense rests on two points. The first is that the accused could not have done otherwise. Like any other agent, he was constrained by the possibilities available to him. The other line of defense invokes the claim that all the creator's actions, in fact, happen for the best. One part of the defense is an inquiry into the grounds of the accused's actions, while the other concerns the true nature of their consequences in the world. It is there that Leibniz's claims look not only prior to experience, but positively immune to it. For he makes quite clear that any fact, however awful, is compatible with the claim that this world is the best of all possible ones. Leibniz's assertion is no claim about the goodness of this world. It simply tells us that any other world would have been worse. Those who want to reject it will be told that they don't know enough to do so, and this is surely true. The statement is just as impossible to disprove as it is to confirm. Take Leibniz's attempt to speculate about how the balance of good and evil might cohere. It's possible, he says, that all crimes and misfortunes are concentrated on this planet. In that case, it would be the lot of human beings to bear the burden of the universe, while inhabitants of other planets are much more blessed and happy than we are. This is possible, of course, but it's no less possible that the denizens of other galaxies exceed us in wickedness and misery. That didn't deter Leibniz from trying the same sort of speculation on the hardest of theological claims for his account, the claim that the number of the damned is greater than the number of the saved. Perhaps, he considers, there is incomparably more good in the glory of all the saved, few as they are in number, than there is evil in the misery of the damned. Perhaps there is. On the face of it, one possibility is just as likely as any other. In the latter case, it is hard to know how to state the alternatives coherently. In the realm of sheer possibility, not much is excluded. Leibniz's defense of God's justice depends on his division of all our misery into metaphysical, natural, and moral evil. It's this division, together with its assumption of a causal link between them, that will strike us as sorely in need of defense. For Leibniz, metaphysical evil is the degeneration inherent in the limits of the substance of which the world is made. Natural evil is the pain and suffering we experience in it. Moral evil is the crime for which natural evil is the certain and inevitable punishment. The assumption that natural and moral evils are causally linked is an assumption Leibniz never subjected to scrutiny. Modern readers may turn every page of the Theodicy with the hope that its author will address the point most in need of argument. But Leibniz held the connection between moral and natural evils to be too self-evident to warrant serious question. The complexity of his accounts of freedom does not make up for the simplicity of his account of the relations between sin and suffering. That account rests on the understanding of the fall, considered most generally as an explanation of why life is not what it should be. Long ago, it was. The earth was a garden in which everything was good. Hunger was stilled without effort. Children were born without pain. We knew neither death, nor shame, nor confusion. If you had to design a world, wouldn't you design it like that? If this is the way things ought to be, something must explain the way they are. The idea that the problem was caused by our ancestors' sins does not depend on what they did. To complain that a taste of the wrong kind of fruit shouldn't be enough to bring a death sentence on the heads of all their descendants is to miss the philosophical point, and Christians' attempts to make the deed look worse than it was are wasted effort. Something trivial is precisely appropriate. What counts in the first instance is not the justice of the connection between what they did and what they suffered, but that there be a connection at all. Why do bad things happen? Because bad things were done. Better to have some causal explanation than to remain in the dark. To connect sin and suffering is to separate the world into moral and natural evils, and to create thereby a framework for understanding human misery. For contemporary readers, the distinction between suffering and sin is so fundamental that 18th century discussion will seem simply confused. The fact that one word, evil, was able to designate both testifies to the closeness of the link conceived between them. For rationalists, the link was straightforwardly causal. Natural evils could be nothing but punishment. To leave room for a neutral conception of suffering and ask about its relation to moral evil was to ask more than faith could bear. Note that the connection between natural and moral evils could be made without reason by any voluntarist. This would be just to say that God makes no concessions to our understanding, but sends what he chooses according to his will. If the rationalist tends to collapse the distinction by making all evils moral ones, the voluntarist's rejection of a comprehensible notion of God's morality tends to make all evils natural. Sin and suffering both come from the Creator, who relates them as he will. For Leibniz, such a view makes God a worse tyrant than the Emperor Caligula, who had his laws written in so small a print and posted in so high a place that no one could read them. A creator who gives us no clear directions about the links between sin and suffering is nothing but a monster. More monstrous still would be a creator who didn't link them at all. All this is traditional enough, though remembering its context makes Leibniz's efforts on God's behalf more poignant. In a world where Bale evoked the nightmares suggested by Calvinism, Manichaeism was a real possibility. Descartes' evil demon was not science fiction, but theology. Leibniz's God may not be a hero, but other options were infinitely worse. What is modern in Leibniz's account is the conviction that the causal links between sin and suffering will become clearer with time, as will the ways in which, despite appearances to the contrary, God has ordered all those links for the best. Leibniz puts his trust in an explanation still to come. We have no evidence that good will come from evil, and quite a lot of reason to doubt it. What makes Leibniz's faith in the future something better than Panglossian? Few thinkers in history were more persuaded of the scope and possibilities created by the early scientific revolutions, and the Theodicy is happy to use them as part of the argument for acknowledging providence. One thing they have taught is a matter of size. Leibniz says ancient beliefs that the universe was puny prevented Augustine from giving an adequate explanation of evil. As long as only one planet was thought to be inhabited, the apparent prevalence of evil over good could not be explained. Now that we know the universe is vast, Leibniz argued, we can better place our own troubles in perspective. Today, the thought of an infinite number of galaxies may give us pause, but only for a moment. For the charge that the problem of evil arises from short-sighted egotism doesn't need modern science for support. It can be found even in the Bible, where the voice from the whirlwind accuses Job of selfishly focusing on his own case. God has ostriches and antelopes to care for as well as human beings. How can Job demand all his attention? Discoveries about the size of the universe cannot support an argument either way, for we were told all along that God's creation was not confined to human being. Either, as the author of Job would thunder, God's hands were quite full with the variety of forms of life on this planet without looking for creatures on others. Alternatively, the skeptic can reply that, unlike an overworked parent, the unspoken metaphor that carries the burden of this argument, God was supposed to be omnipotent. Thus, the discovery that the universe is larger than supposed cannot be among the discoveries of science that will prove much help with the problem of evil. Among the other sources of his confidence is Leibniz's invention of the calculus, which made him not only one of the greatest admirers of the early scientific revolutions, but also an agent of them. But the leap Leibniz imagined from the calculus he and Newton simultaneously invented to the universal calculus that would be the basis of the science of the future seems almost as vast today as the universe that then impressed him. Indeed, what's hard to understand is the tenacity of Leibniz's belief in the discovery of a method that would solve every problem. His most famous vision of the future is one in which two people warring over politics or religion would exchange their swords for pencils. With a cheerful, "Come, let us calculate," they would solve every disagreement as easily as we solve equations. The universal calculus would not only resolve old problems, but would function as a logic of discovery. It would work so well that even a scientist who wished to go astray would fail to do so. His hand, said Leibniz, would refuse to write an error. For the calculus would reveal the rational order in language as ordinary language does not. Sometimes Leibniz thought of it as the language spoken by Adam before the Tower of Babel. Elsewhere, he holds it to have a form only mathematics can capture. Once he tried to work it out in hieroglyphics. Though none of these attempts came close to fruition, he was so convinced that the next would be successful that he bade his readers give thought to the greatest problem future science would face, gratifying vanity. For once the universal calculus was discovered, all the sciences, from metaphysics to history, would be completed so effortlessly and automatically that any fool could do it. What challenge would be left for ambitious young talent? Leibniz did not expect all his readers to share his own confidence in the inevitability of scientific triumph. The distinctions between early rationalists and empiricists were less fixed than post-Kantian polemics often suggest. Still, Leibniz's exchanges with leading empiricists like Locke, Clark, and Bayle taught him to expect the charge that he placed too much trust in reason. Here Alfonso could help, for he signified all the follies of empiricism. The appeal to experience is, in the end, always appeal to experience limited by particular place and time. Poring over Ptolemaic tables by torchlight, Alfonso concluded that the universe was deficient. Within the boundaries of his own experience, his conclusion made sense. Recall that it was not only Ptolemaic astronomy, but also ordinary experience and common sense that put the Earth in the center of the universe. Which of our senses tells us that the Earth moves? Had Alfonso but lived to see the discoveries of Copernicus and Kepler, he would have marveled at the system and harmony with which the universe is run. The fault lay not in the universe, but in the poverty of Alfonso's experience, and this should give us pause. It's a mark of the modern that Leibniz no longer found the king appalling, but subjected him to ridicule in a message that was perfectly clear. Anyone inclined to challenge the fact that Leibniz's defense of God was utterly a priori should consider the alternative. In another few centuries, understanding of the universe and God's purposes in it should progress unimaginably. Today's scoffers will look as silly as a Spanish king shaking his head over antiquated astronomy and complaining that the world makes no sense. Alfonso makes the appeal to experience itself look ridiculous, while Leibniz buys time for science to prove this world to be the best. Quote, "If we hold the same opinion as King Alfonso, we shall, I say, receive this answer. You have known the world only since the day before yesterday. You see scarce further than your nose, and you carpet the world. Wait until you know more of the world, and you will find there a contrivance and beauty transcending all imagination. Let us thence draw conclusions as to the wisdom of goodness of the author of things, even in the things we know not. End quote. In passages such as this and other parts of the Theodicy, Leibniz offered himself as a defender of the faith, in contrast to those ridiculous critics of God's works who use the awfulness of experience to claim that God might have done better. His defense of God argued that God could not have done any better than he did. But every lawyer has his price. In the process of defending God, Leibniz disempowered him. More exactly, Leibniz went so far in meeting our needs for understanding the Creator in terms with which we make sense that he gave us a God created in our image. Hegel compared him to a vendor in an open market. Leibniz's God can only offer what's available. We should not grumble if the produce isn't perfect, but should be content when we know it's the best that can be had. Hegel's metaphor may seem unfair. Neoplatonists could explain evil by defects in the nature of matter. As a Christian, Leibniz was bound by the view that God is also the creator of matter itself. His God is no greengrocer, but the maker of seeds, weather, markets, and buyers alike. How, then, to explain the defects in all of them? Leibniz's solution was to move all the problems back. God created matter, but not form. The truth of everything, including the essence of every possible object, is contained in the eternal forms, which function in ways similar to a simple reading of Plato's. Before God decided which of all possible worlds he should choose to make real, he looked at all the forms, calculated which ones would fit together, and chose the best of all possible combinations. The forms are just the rules of reason. Imagining God to want to be free of them is to imagine a God who is mad. Yet in defending God against voluntarism, Leibniz did just that of which rationalism is traditionally accused. He put reason above God himself. Reading Leibniz together with Hegel, one begins to think in pictures. God comparing essences in a ghostly supermarket. If reason itself is more powerful than God, since it prescribes laws that presume to limit him, it is no wonder that God could come to seem superfluous. The late idealist choice to ignore the middleman and enthrone reason itself might seem just a matter of good sense dictated by Occam's razor as well as burgeoning market economics. Thus, the orthodox charge against every form of rationalism could come to seem comprehensible. To demand or give reasons for God's behavior is to demand to judge him. Even if the judgment comes out in his favor, it involves an element of presumption that religious views will find unacceptable. In vain will the rationalist protest that reason too is God's creation and we shouldn't despise his gifts. The traditionalist must answer, did he give it because he thought he would require our help? The process by which the wish to defend God with reasons would become the wish to displace God with reason was a long one. If the wisdom of hindsight lets us understand traditional fears, the early Enlightenment did not. All to the contrary. Much has been made of the ways in which the scientific revolutions led to skepticism about religious tradition by challenging accepted worldviews. Far less has been said about the ways in which, at the time, they seemed to support faith. Eventually, it may be true that faith in science replaced faith in God. For a very long time, it only strengthened it. The idea goes back to the Renaissance and reached its peak in the middle of the 18th century. Pope's couplet, cut as the great man's epitaph, likened the birth of Newton to a second creation. Quote, nature and nature's laws lay hid in night. God said, let Newton be, and all was light. End quote. But it wasn't only Newton. Every new discovery seemed to prove the argument from design. Indeed, for the 18th century, the argument from design was less an argument than a piece of hard data. Its central claim was just this: the evidence for God's existence is nothing less than the whole of creation. For the latter is so shot through with order and design that it could not have originated by accident. We needn't point to something as grand or distant as the heavens. The structure of our own hands or eyes will do as well. Designs of that intricacy require a designer. As Newton's expositor Samuel Clarke summarized, quote, "Yet the notices that God has been pleased to give us of himself are so many and so obvious in the constitution, order, beauty, and harmony of the several parts of the world, in the form and structure of our own bodies, and the wonderful powers and faculties of our souls, in the unavoidable apprehensions of our own minds, and the common consent of all other men, in everything within us and everything without us, that no man of the meanest capacity and greatest disadvantages whatsoever, with the slightest and most superficial observation of the works of God, and the lowest and most obvious attendance to the reason of things, can be ignorant of him, but he must be utterly without excuse." End quote. Science was viewed not as a rival, but as a servant of faith, since every new discovery was a discovery of law. Any advance of science was proof of more order in the universe. Even further, our ability to make discoveries was evidence of our own powers, and of the fit between those powers and the natural world. Wonder upon wonder, God had created human minds and a natural world that were exactly and perfectly balanced to respond to each other. Each new discovery would confirm the glory of each. In his book Religion Within the Limits of Reason Alone, written at the close of the 18th century, Kant wrote that King David could never have adored the Creator as we can, for he knew too little of the wonders of creation. Thus his psalms must pass as empty sound, for the emotion we feel on contemplating the work of God's hand, now manifest in modern science, is too great to express. Such views were as present in literature as in philosophy, in French as in German. The 18th century bestseller, L'An 2440, was a utopian tract depicting Enlightenment fantasies of a future without the injustice and misery of the old regime. Despite all his radicalism, its Rousseau-inspired author imagined religious education that required future generations to look through the telescope and microscope in order to reveal God's presence and glory through this, quote, "communion of two infinities." If, by some aberration, an atheist were to appear among them, the Parisians would bring him around with an assiduous course of experimental physics, end quote. Contemplating such texts makes it easier to understand Leibniz's confidence that somehow or another, science would find the hidden connections between happiness and virtue that current experience fails to show. Bale, says Leibniz, asks, quote, "a little too much. He wishes for a detailed explanation of how evil is connected with the best possible scheme for the universe. That would be a complete explanation of the phenomena," end quote. A complete explanation is an unreasonable demand, particularly in an era exploding with excitement over partial ones. The example of Alfonso was hope and warning at once, not itself a discovery or a method for making one, but the sort of thing that could keep one going in the absence of either. Didn't the world get more intelligible all the time? An unhappy traveler, uncertain of reaching his goal, draws comfort from looking backward to recall how far he's come. The early Enlightenment took Alfonso as consolation. He made clear how great was our progress in grasping the world. Inexplicable death and pain, of course, did not diminish in the wake of 18th century science's discoveries, but neither did expectations of coming to understand them. For hopes were high to behold, or preferably to be, the Newton of the mind. The nearly universal confidence that there would be one may seem amusing for those used to deep conflict between science and the soul, through religion or the categories of ordinary psychology. But we should not read our own distinctions between what the 18th century called natural and moral sciences into earlier eras, any more than we should our distinctions between natural and moral evils. For an age that had yet to distinguish between hard and soft sciences, the expectation that someone would do for mind what Newton had done for matter was almost trivial. Each was just a piece of the universe waiting to be explained. Much less obvious was the kind of explanation that was expected. To wish to be the Newton of the mind was not to wish to explain mental experience in physical terms. The search for naturalistic explanation was not yet, or not universally, a search for mechanistic explanation. Natural was opposed to supernatural and meant something like law-like. but the type of law that would turn out to be explanatory was hardly fixed. Two things that the 18th century expected of a second Newton will surprise contemporary readers, but they are clear from the most important texts we have on the subject, an early note Kant left unpublished. The Newton of the mind, it indicates, would answer King Alfonso's objection that God's design is flawed. It is for this reason that Leibniz had promised that causal connections between moral and physical evils now hidden would be made manifest with the progress of science. Suffering that seems entirely random, hence liable to make us doubt God's goodness, would be shown to be the effect of some sin we had secretly committed. Moreover, suffering would be shown to be itself the cause of some greater good, so that the network of causality, now partly traceable through the physical universe, would be seamlessly extended to the moral one. If this seems far-fetched, imagine how implausible a connection between the phases of the moon and the motion of the tides must have seemed. After these had been placed in a causal relation, what other sorts of connection might not be soon to come? The second service expected of the coming Newton follows from the first one. A Newton of the mind would not remove God's presence from the universe by reducing spirit to soulless mechanism, as is often suggested, but would eloquently testify to it. Newton viewed his work as testimony to the glory of God, and no 18th century admirer would have disagreed. Alfonso's doubts about the cosmos had been laid to rest forever by the English scientist, who was rewarded for his labor in defense of the Creator by the repeated epithet immortal, along with the earthly title Sir Isaac. While most of early science was viewed as a series of proofs for the argument from design, Newton's was paradigmatic. Not only had he seen connections where others saw chaos, found the most elegant and far-reaching formulas, joined heaven and earth by relating their movements. Even more precisely, Newton had shown that given a description of the initial conditions and properties of all its parts, one could derive the state of the system of the universe at any given time. Once the system is set in motion, it runs more or less on its own. Later, it would seem clear that a God whose only task was to create a perfect world might be in danger of disappearing from it. But at the time, Newton's vision was a vision of God's greatness. For most 17th and 18th century thinkers, God's presence was such a given that consequences which now seem obvious will not have occurred to them. People feared an incompetent God, like Alfonso's, or a malevolent God, like Descartes'. As the following chapter will argue, the Enlightenment offered possibilities that seem more frightening than any we now imagine, but an entirely absent God was rarely among them. The Theodicy is often credited with inspiring Pope's essay on man. Published in 1734, the essay was probably the 18th century's favorite poem. Kant was wont to quote Pope in university lectures, Voltaire was happy to translate him, and when Hume addressed the question whether politics can be scientific, his starting point wasn't Montesquieu, but the English poet. The meaning of Pope's views was debated from one end of Europe to the other. Part of such debate was a contest sponsored by the Prussian Academy. The questions proposed by the Academy tell us much about the framework of 18th century intellectual culture. Quote, the Academy requests an investigation into the Popian system which contains the sentence, everything is good. In particular, each contestant should first determine what the true sense of this sentence is, according to its author. Second, exactly compare it to the system of optimism or the choice of the best. Thirdly, state the reasons for or against accepting the Popian system. End quote. The exactness of analysis of the questions at issue is only apparent, as the most famous entry to the contest was at pains to show. Pope, a Metaphysician, is its title, and Lessing and Mendelssohn clearly enjoyed co-authoring it. It's hard to imagine any other motive for writing, since the scorn they heaped on the Academy for posing the question virtually ensured that the prize would go to someone else. Their discussion is occasionally funny, but more often reminiscent of the pedantic swagger with which some philosophers discuss literary texts in private. Their main point, argued at greater length than it need be, is that Pope is a poet concerned to clothe philosophical ideas in attractive dress, but unable to develop them with any depth or consistency. Hence, they conclude, he's unworthy of serious philosophical engagement. For this reason alone, he differs from Leibniz. Perhaps they share certain moral claims, but their principles are entirely different. Lessing and Mendelssohn were right to stress Pope's distance from Leibniz. Pope may seem to simply mold the well-meant orthodoxies that Leibniz defended, but in fact he undermines them, as many of his contemporaries recognized. In so doing, he takes crucial steps toward the world we will see in Rousseau. That world is not apparent from many of the essay's most famous verses. Quote, all nature is but art, unknown to thee. All chance, direction, which thou canst not see. All discord, harmony not understood. All partial evil, universal good. And in spite of pride and erring reason's spite, one truth is clear, whatever is right. End quote. This certainly sounds like Leibniz, except that it is written as a poem and not a legal brief, thus making enjoyable a message in which modern readers will find little else to enjoy. Pope seems to assert the unbroken goodness of creation as it stands, the existence of an order behind appearances which assures that unbroken goodness, and the presumption and ignorance of anyone who dares to suggest the world could be improved. Pope's very art may seem to lend fervor to his defense of the established order that makes it even more alien than Leibniz's. Quote, all this dread order break, for whom, for thee? Vile worm, oh madness, pride, impiety. End quote. But Pope knew that his contemporaries would regard the essay differently, and he took care to publish anonymously. For even this seemingly conservative claim could be read as seditious. As Voltaire pointed out, if whatever is right, there is no room for original sin or providence itself. Progressive intellectuals may have loved it, but traditional readers described it as a nursery of heretical opinions and the chief cause of vice among Christians. One critic compared Pope to Eve seducing Adam in the Garden of Eden, for like her, he pandered to his readers' lower faculties with the beauty of his verse and befuddled their minds by overheating their bodies. The quarrel between philosophy and poetry is an old one, as is the philosopher's suspicion of good writing as merely seductive. Relatively generous critics like Lessing and Mendelssohn saw the work as simply confused, but hostile critics called it intentionally confusing. They charged that Pope manipulated readers with sensual pleasure to mask corrupt, impious views. Pope cannot have been unaware of the tension between the genres when he decided to write philosophical poetry. Presumably, he chose it because neither medium alone was fit to express what he wanted. Poetry itself never seeks the kinds of judgments of meaning and morals that Pope often intended. But philosophy alone is too straightforward, too unambiguous to do justice to the complexity Pope saw in the human condition. Poetry has a wider range of responses than those open to philosophy, mixing tones, changing mood and mode, shifting from the somber to the ironic without looking for grounds. The unclarity of which Pope was accused is, I believe, entirely intentional. He sought to reflect, not to resolve, the complexity of the questions at issue. The essay has been called an exercise in which a very troubled writer struggled to convince himself of a system of ideas he could not wholly accept. This is probably true. Poetry can record that struggle without settling it, and this alone may give it an advantage over philosophy, which seeks conclusive solution. Pope's essay records the struggle between hope and despair that can take place daily in anyone who thinks about the questions he raised. By using poetry, he could use resources of irony, metaphor, and paradox to hold that struggle in tension without seeking to resolve it. For resolving it would require him to reduce the very many perspectives one can take on the matter into one final and decisive one. Since the poem itself is about the multiplicity of perspective, such finality would be false to the reality of human experience. One of Pope's first critics complained, quote, have poets so extensive a privilege that they may boldly assert the wildest paradoxes, provided they utter them in sounding language? End quote. The question is meant to be rhetorical, but the answer, I think, is yes, they do. Part of the work of poetry is just to express paradox without absurdity, to give form to contradiction without stilling it, to give voice to tension without dissolving it. Poets can leave things open, that philosophers cannot. Pope uses question almost as often as he uses assertion, makes hypothetical as often as categorical statements. In so doing, he not only states our ignorance of the great metaphysical questions he seeks to resolve, one major theme of the essay, but shows it in the very form of the text. If Pope loves to remind us of how little we understand, the paradoxes and shifts in the poem allow us to feel it. When we cannot even determine Pope's position on the problem of evil, how can we hope to find a solution to the problem itself? To emphasize the skepticism 18th-century readers felt in the poem, rather than the affirmation of order now apparent to us, seems to put Pope closer to Bayle than to Leibniz. Like Bayle, Pope denied that we can understand the order of the universe and thought it foolish and arrogant to try. This amounts to the claim that only faith can resolve the problem of evil with which Leibniz and other metaphysicians had wrestled. But unlike Bayle, who was content to regard most things as beyond our understanding, Pope's poem began to suggest that there is some problem of evil that might be within our reach. With this, he unlocked a door to the modern that Rousseau would open. For the essay that began and ended with a defense of providence is, after all, the essay on man. Modern readers may be surprised by how little interest Leibniz showed in the human. The theodicy devoted a great deal more attention to divine than to human freedom, and makes reference to human choice and passion more by way of example than anything else. 18th-century readers analyzed fine differences between Pope's whatever is right and Leibniz's everything happens for the best. But perhaps the greatest difference is that it is impossible to imagine Leibniz's claim followed by the great couplet with which Pope followed his. Quote, "Know then thyself, presume not God to scan, the proper study of mankind is man." End quote. Traditional readers lambasted the poem for focusing on man rather than immortal man, the latter being the only object thought proper for pious and serious contemplation. With his very title, Pope signaled a shift of focus from God's nature and responsibilities to our own. In so doing, he began to push the problem of evil out of the realm of metaphysics and theology into the world of ethics and psychology, and therewith to a set of questions we can recognize as our own. Pope directs us to understand ourselves, our passions, and our possibilities, for only these have bearing on any problem of evil we may hope to effect. The absence of a notion of original sin and the cheerful description of the initial state of nature foreshadowed Rousseau's. So did the moral psychology Pope drew from them. His attempt to give a naturalistic account of the passions was not as deep or complex as Rousseau's, nor was his claim that ordinary self-love can be cultivated to aim at the general good. Still, they point in the same direction, and the consequences were plain. For those committed to belief in original sin, salvation could only come by grace, or, depending on how much freedom one ascribed to individuals, by repeated threats of eternal damnation. But if, as Pope thought, our own self-love is inherently social, then acting virtuously is natural. It may even be pleasant. If that's the case, what's needed to eradicate most evils is not prayers and threats, but self-knowledge and social arrangements. This is anything but the cosmic Toryism of which Pope was later accused. A poet with Pope's eye for irony would have been amused to learn that the naturalist impulse, which was born in service of religion, came to seem antithetical to it. But the original intention is evident not only in Pope's claim that God's wise design links self-love and sociability, but in his far-reaching attack on the appeal to final causes. The rejection of final causes was not undertaken simply in service of mechanical ones. Rather, Pope believed that thinking in terms of final causes leads to rebellion and despair. Assuming the world is made to suit our purposes, we are outraged and miserable when it doesn't. To recognize that the universe is not created for our needs is not to assert that it's indifferent to them. The line between patience and resignation is one Pope wished to preserve. His insistence that the final causes of things cannot be known and should therefore drop out of view is meant to keep the balance. His examples can be chilling. A man who thinks that all the world exists for his benefit is no better than a pampered goose who believes that the farmer who fattens him exists for his. Removing teleology from the world began as an attempt to preserve significance, not to destroy it. The ultimate meaning of creation may be forever out of our reach. But this, for Pope, was no ground for despair. We need not fear that its resistance to our purposes means it has none at all. Newton of the Mind, Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Suggestions are not science, however well expressed. As much as Kant loved to quote Pope, he never called him a second Newton. That was an honor he reserved for Rousseau. This is anything but obvious. In an age when it was common to work in multiple genres, Rousseau was extravagant. He wrote opera and literature, as well as tracts declaiming against them, moved from political theory to theology with ease and erudition, and in the Emile and the Confessions, invented genres of his own. The one thing he did not engage in, unlike most of his contemporaries, was anything they would have classified as science, with the exception of a small treatise on botany he wrote towards the end of his life. Yet Kant believed that only Rousseau was comparable to Newton. This meant, he wrote, that Rousseau had justified God and proved Pope's thesis true. We must assume that the thesis of Pope which Kant has in mind is the one the 18th century quoted most often, whatever is right. Rousseau will have proved it if he has refuted the objections of Alfonso and the Manichaeans. But why did Kant write that before Rousseau these objections were valid? Leibniz used Alfonso to counsel patience. As rhetoric, it was probably more effective than the maledictions preferred by others. Instead of calling those who complain about the quality of creation vile worms, Leibniz made them targets of ridicule. After being a fool, how did Alfonso become again a threat? How does a straw become the last one? The metaphor underscores just the thinness of causal explanation. Burdens grow until the beast collapses under the accumulated weight of contradiction, disappointment, and exhaustion. The 18th century faith in scientific discoveries that would reinforce traditional faith in providence was not destroyed by any single event. Lisbon focused the problem, but it didn't invent it. For one thing, natural disaster was part of the literature. Pope had no trouble mentioning plagues, earthquakes, and volcanoes. All these were events that no serious thinker took to undermine belief in the greatness of creation. Significantly, he attacks those who hold moral evils to be a greater threat than natural ones. Quote, if plagues or earthquakes break not nature's design, why then a Borgia or a Catiline? End quote. At least two reasons were offered for the suggestion that moral evils threaten faith in providence more surely than do natural ones. The first was that natural evils display something sublime, even beautiful, that cannot be found in moral ones. No decent Enlightenment thinker regarded moral evils as anything but vile. Even more important was the persistent assumption that natural evils exist as punishment for moral ones. The former, therefore, required no justification. Far from breaking heaven's design, they were a crucial part of it, for they were evidence of a moral order in which every sin had consequences. More puzzling was a world whose creator allowed crimes that would require such punishment. This was a Leibnizian problem, the reason he devoted the bulk of the theodicy to developing a notion of divine freedom that could function in the limits of necessity. Pope clearly found it less troubling. This was partly because he was beginning to develop notions of moral psychology that would allow for explanations of moral evil.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.